Welcome students, this is a short video on the anatomy of the spinal cord. In this I am going to tell you about the external feature of the spinal cord, then I will also introduce you with some of the internal features of the spinal cord, for example the arrangement of the gray matter and the white matter inside the spinal cord. And then I will tell you about the presence of the various columns, white columns, that is the tracts. Okay, just will name them. Okay, I will not go into the details. And then I will tell you about the various group of the nuclei which are present into the sensory and the motor gray columns. Okay, so this is going to just an introductory short lecture on to the anatomy of the spinal cord, and after that the second video will be on the spinal nerves and formation of the plexus, right? And the third video on the spinal cord, where I may go in details about the tracts, okay, and its applied importance, okay. So now I move to the next slide, okay, and this is a slide which is showing you the spinal cord, okay. Now if you see the location of the spinal cord, the spinal cord is a cylindrical structure which is located in upper two-thirds of the vertebral canal. Upper two-thirds of the vertebral canal, that means it terminates at the lower border of L1 vertebra, okay. So it begins at the upper border of the cervical 1 vertebrae, where it is in continuation with that of the medulla, and then below this it is the spinal cord at the upper border of cervical first, and terminates at the lower border of L1 in adults, okay. Now if you see the length of the spinal cord, it is about 43 to 45 centimeter, and it weighs around 30 grams, okay, its weight. Now if you will see the spinal cord, let us see this spinal cord in this diagram, and then you will see that this spinal cord is having the two fusiform swellings, okay. The two fusiform swellings are seen in this spinal cord, and these are called as, the upper one is called as cervical enlargement, and the lower one is called as the lumbosacral enlargement, okay. It is called as the lumbosacral. Now this cervical enlargement, which is present in the spinal cord, it is extending from cervical fourth vertebrae right up to the thoracic 1 vertebrae, okay. And this cervical part of the enlargement of the spinal cord is responsible for giving origin to the spinal nerves, which will form the brachial plexus to supply the upper limb, okay. And that is the reason why this fusiform enlargement is here, because it contains large numbers of motor neurons which are required to supply the muscles of the upper limb, okay, upper limb. Similarly, this lumbosacral enlargement, or simply the lumbar enlargement, it extends from the lumbar first vertebrae up to the sacral third vertebrae, okay. Lumbar first spinal segment to the sacral third spinal segment of the spinal cord, and this is responsible for giving origin to the spinal nerves, which will ultimately form the lumbosacral plexus, okay. And this plexus will be extending from the segment L2 to S3, and this lumbosacral plexus will supply to the thick muscles, okay, strong muscles of the lower limb, okay. And thus these fusiform swellings which are seen in the spinal cord, the cervical enlargement and lumbosacral enlargement, they are just an adaptation for to supply the limb enlargement, that is for the muscles of the upper limb and that of the lower limb. Okay, lower limb. Now, when this spinal cord is passing through this vertebral canal, it is surrounded by the meninges, that is dura mater and arachnoid matter, and deep to arachnoid matter, there is the collection of the cerebrospinal fluid. Okay, though as we have learned that this spinal cord is extending only up to the lower level of L1 vertebrae, but beyond this level there is the presence of the spinal nerves only, okay, which we will learn later. They are called as the cauda equina. So in this canal, right from up to the coccygeal region, this is well protected, okay, well protected by the meninges and the cerebrospinal fluid, and also by the vertebrae, okay, which forms the vertebral canal. They are successive articulation, they form the vertebral canal. Now I am moving to the next slide, and in this slide we will see some of the external features of the spinal cord. Let us see the conus medullaris, phylum terminale, and cauda equina. I will just explain you what is the conus medullaris. This is the conus medullaris, means the lowermost part of the spinal cord, which becomes a cone-like structure, and it is present just below that of the lumbosacral enlargement, and it lies at the level of the lower border of L1 vertebra. That's why it is called as conus. Okay, and from the tip of the conus medullaris, there extend a fibrous strain. Okay, and this fibrous strain, you know, it goes right up to the coccyx vertebrae. Yeah, coccyx first vertebrae, where it fuses with the body of the coccyx vertebrae. Okay, or coccyx. Now this is called as phylum terminale. Okay, the extension from tip of the conus medullaris to that of the coccyx vertebrae, it is called as the phylum terminale. It doesn't contain any, nervous part. This is just a fibrous strand. Mostly the tissue of the pia mater, they condense and form the conus, the phylum terminale. Now, what is cauda equina? Now, the bunch of the nerves which are seen here, taking origin from the lumbar part, then from the sacral and coccygeal part of the spinal cord segments, they ultimately are arranged in the form of the bunch. You can see in this diagram also, see there's so many spinal nerves, they are going together, and ultimately they will come out from the respective intervertebral foramina. So they form a bunch here, and that bunch, which is surrounding to the conus medullaris and to that of the phylum terminale, is called as the cauda equina, which resembles to the hairs in the tail of the horse. Okay, a bunch of the hairs. So it resembles to that. That's why it is called as cauda equina. Okay. Now, cauda equina, as I said, is a bunch of the spinal nerves around the phylum terminale, which are going to their destination, and they are going to the respective intervertebral foramina, and it contains the spinal nerves from the lumbar region, from the sacral region, and the coccygeal region. Okay, coccygeal region. Now, why this bunch is present here? Okay, and why these fibers are going downwards to come out from their respective foramina? This is because of the shortening of the spinal cord as compared to the length of the vertebral column. In the fetal age, early fetal age, both the spinal cord and this vertebral canal, they were of same length. All the spinal nerves were there, they were coming at the same height, okay, corresponding through the corresponding intervertebral foramina. But because of the differential growth of the vertebral column, which was growing at a much faster level, while the neurological tissue, that means the spinal cord, this was growing at a less speed, okay? Lesser speed compared to that of the vertebral column. And that is the reason why the spinal nerves, they are forming the bunch here called as the cauda equina. Now, there are 31 pairs of the spinal nerve which are coming out from the spinal segments, and thus there are 31 spinal segments. If I tell you about the spinal segment, there are 8 cervical, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar, 5 sacral and coccyx. Okay, there may be the coccygeal one segment, okay, which may give rise to a coccyx nerve. Now, this spinal nerves which are coming out, okay, from the spinal cord, they have a special arrangement of there. That means there is an anterior root and posterior root which forms the trunk, and then it divides into the rami, anterior and or ventral rami, and dorsal or posterior rami. That we will cover in our next video about the spinal nerves, okay? So now I am moving to the next slide, where I will tell you further about the structure of the spinal cord. Now this diagram is a showing you the three spinal cord segments, okay? And what is the spinal cord segment? I have told you that there are 31 spinal cord segment which gives origin to 31 pairs of the nerve. Pairs means, okay, 31 on right side and 31 on to the left side of the spinal nerves, they take origin. And in this diagram, only three segments are shown, just to give you an idea. And only on one side, these spinal nerves are shown here, okay, origin of the spinal nerve itself. Now, if we define the spinal cord segment, then we may say that this is a portion of the spinal cord, okay? It is spinal cord segment is a portion of the spinal cord, okay, which will give origin to a pair of the roots, okay, spinal nerve roots, okay? So it is a portion of the cord to which a pair of a dorsal and ventral spinal roots are attached. These are rootlets, okay? So it is called as the root here. Okay, so this is the root which is taking origin from the ventral aspect of the spinal cord. Hence, this root is called as the ventral root, spinal root. And here this is the, on the dorsal aspect, okay, this is now roots, rootlets, and then the nerve root which is coming out, it is called as the dorsal spinal nerve, okay? So the ventral and dorsal spinal nerve, and through its rootlets, which is taking origin from that part of the spinal cord, and that portion is called as a single spinal segment. So here is one, second rootlets, the third rootlets. So that's why I can say that this is the diagram is showing the three spinal segments. So I hope you have understood what are the spinal segments, okay, through which a spinal nerve takes its origin, both from right as well as from left side. So there are, in this way, 31 spinal nerves are taking origin from right side, and 31 they are taking origin from left side. That's why it consists of the 31 segments, spinal segment. Let us go to see some of the other external feature of the spinal cord beside this attachment of the spinal nerve. This is the anterior or ventral aspect of the spinal cord, and it will be better understood if we see it in relation to its transverse section, okay? So this is a section of the spinal cord cut at the top by in transversely, and then a part of the spinal cord is shown, showing the three spinal segments. Now in the midline on the ventral or anterior aspect of the spinal cord, you are seeing a deep fissure, okay? And this deep fissure is present exactly in the median plane or anterior median fissure. That's why called as anterior median fissure, as I said that it is present in the median or midline plane. So this fissure, which is deep, extending deep inside, okay, this is called as anterior median fissure. Just opposite on the posterior aspect of the spinal cord, there is no fissure, deep fissure. It is only a sulcus, sulcus is present, and that is called as the posteromedian fissure, again in midline, hence called as posteromedian fissure. Now if you see on the lateral aspect of this anteromedian fissure, on either side there is another sulcus is seen here, that is called as anterolateral sulcus. That means it may be right anterolateral sulcus, and this is the left anterolateral sulcus. And in the similar way, there is another sulcus present here, okay, on posterior aspect, okay, on right as well as on left side of the posteromedian sulcus, and this is called as posterolateral sulcus. So it is the postero. So now you have understood what are the fissures, a single fissure, and what are the sulci seen in the spinal cord. You should note that in this anterolateral fissure, anterolateral sulcus, you see this is anterolateral sulcus, there is the attachment of the rootlets of the spinal nerve. Similarly, in the posterolateral sulcus, there are the attachments of the dorsal rootlets of a spinal nerves, okay, dorsal rootlets. So these are the anterolateral and posterolateral sulci, which gives attachment to the rootlets of the spinal nerves. Now, after learning this basic external feature of the spinal cord, this is time to come to the internal structure of the spinal cord. When we cut a internal structure, transverse section of the spinal cord, we will note that, okay, we will note that it is, just a minute please, let me go back. We will note that, okay, there is the presence of the centrally placed gray matter. It is the centrally placed gray matter, okay. See, this H-shaped gray matter is present, okay. And then it is surrounded peripherally by the white matter. Now, then question comes, what is the gray matter which is present here centrally? A gray matter is the collection of the nerve cells or neurons and their initial process, axons and dendrites, okay, a part of the axons mostly, it is collection of the nerve cells, neuron and neuroglial cells, okay, that is collection within the central nervous system is called as the, anywhere in the nervous system is called as the gray matter, it is called. So this is the gray matter, and it is surrounded by the white matter all around. As we have seen, this is called as the white matter because this is the collection of the nerve fibers, mostly axons, okay, and mostly myelinated axons they surround. And these axons are arranged in the form of the ascending and descending tracts in spinal cord. And what is a tract? Tract is a bundle of the axons or this dendrons or dendrites which are ascending or descending. Mostly it is axon, okay. For some distance it may be a dendrite also, but it is mostly an axons which are ascending and descending, and a bunch of the axons which carry, have the same origin, that means their point of origin is same, and their destination where they will end is also the same, and they carry a similar kind of the information or impulses. That part of the bundle of the white fibers or axons is called as the tract. Okay, so this white matter is nothing but the collection of many ascending that means sensory, and descending, that means motor fibers, okay, or tracts, okay, tract. So now you understand what is a gray matter and what is a white matter. Now you will see that this gray matter here is arranged in a A-shaped manner, okay, and this is gray matter is thus divided into the this posterior gray column or the dorsal gray column. Then there is an anterior gray column, okay, towards the anterior aspect, and in between the anterior gray column and posterior gray column there is another projection is seen in some part of the spinal cord that is called as the lateral gray column. So you should note that this lateral gray column is not present everywhere in the spinal cord. It is present from the thoracic 1 to the lumbar 2 segment and again in the sacral S2 to S4 segment. Otherwise, in other parts of the spinal cord segments, this lateral horn or the lateral gray column is not present. Okay, so the gray matter is thus divided into a dorsal or posterior gray column or horn, sometimes called as a lateral gray column, and then this is an anterior gray column. Now this three columns of the gray matters, they are just attached to each other by this horizontal part, and this is called as the gray commissure. This is called as gray commissure. That means the columns of one side is attached, I mean say is continuous with that of the columns of the other side by the gray commissure, and there is a presence of a canal running throughout the spinal cord. It is called as the central canal. Okay, now there are neurons which are present into the anterior, lateral and posterior gray column or posterior horn. Okay, horn. These are of different nature, which I will tell you later. Okay, which I will tell you later. But just remember that there is collection of the neurons, and on the peripheral aspect of this gray column, these are the white matter. Again, the white matter is also organized on the right side and left side here, and they are classified as the dorsal funiculus. That means on either side of the postromedian septum, there is a fibrous septum which divide the posterior white column into right and left side. Okay, so the posterior funiculus or the posterior white column, one is the same thing. This is the posterior white column which is present between the postromedian septum to that of the this is dorsal gray column or dorsal gray horn. Then this dorsal gray horn is the posterolateral sulcus. This will give attachment to the posterior rootlets of the spinal nerve, and this is anterolateral sulcus which will give origin to the ventral rootlets or anterior rootlet of a spinal nerve. Thus between the posterolateral sulcus and anterolateral sulcus, whatsoever white matter is present here, which is called as the white funiculus here, is called as the lateral funiculus. This will be called as our lateral white column, lateral white column. And then between the anterior median fissure and the anterolateral sulcus, the part of the white matter which is present here, it is called as the anterior funiculus or anterior white column. Thus we have seen that there are three parts of the gray matter which is S-shaped, and there are the three parts of the white matter surrounding to the gray columns, okay, on either side, on the right side and the left side of the spinal cord. Okay, now I move to the next slide. Now let us come to the nuclei which are present within the gray column. Now this is the dorsal gray column, and the dorsal gray column consists of the nuclei which are I mean say the nerve cells which are sensory in nature. And these nerve cells in the dorsal column, they have arranged themselves into each, I mean say into a small groups, okay? They are arranged in the small groups, okay? Because they have, must have arranged themselves because they saw the different types of the functions, sensory function. So what are the, this gray column, I mean say nuclei which are, and what is nuclei? Nuclei is nothing but the collection of the neurons within the central nervous system, a group of the neurons which forms a group, isolated group. So these are the group of the neurons within the central nervous system. They are called as nuclei or nucleus. Single is nucleus, okay? Now what are these nuclei? These nuclei are here. This is the marginal nucleus at the margin. Then substantia gelatinosa, I am not going into detail, I am just naming them because we will learn in great detail later. The third nucleus is nucleus properius, it is called as nucleus properius. Then going towards the ventral side or anterior side, this next nucleus is the nucleus dorsalis, which is also called as Clark's column. And then this nucleus here, close to that of the central canal here, is the intermedio-medial group of nucleus. Intermedio-medial group of nucleus. So there are many nuclei present into the posterior gray column or posterior gray horns. Okay. Let us go to the motor nuclei in anterior and lateral gray column or the horns. Now, in the thoracic region, see this is a section passing through the thoracic spinal cord, and this section is passing through the enlargement, cervical enlargement or the lumbosacral enlargement, because here the anterior gray column is very big because it contains so many nuclei which are supplying to the enlargement or the limb enlargement muscles, okay, upper limb and the lower limb muscle. But in case of the thoracic, the anterior gray column or horn is very narrow because here it has to only supply the intercostal muscle of the thoracic region, right? So in this, what you are seeing is that there is a medial group and then there is a lateral group of the nuclei, okay, motor neurons. Anterior horn shows the motor neurons. The motor neurons means these neurons, they will send there through the spinal rootlets, spinal nerve, it will send the axon ultimately to the skeletal muscles, where this muscle, this neuron will send the fibers to individual skeletal muscle fibers, and the stimulation of this neuron under the influence of the cerebral cortex will lead to the contraction of the muscle, thus the movements will be produced. So these are the motor neuron, okay? Somatic motor neuron. Their function or the contraction of the muscle is as per your will. You can make your muscle contract if you desire so. So this is that somatic neurons. Motor neurons are there, and they are in thoracic region, they are arranged in two groups, a medial group and a lateral group, okay? But here, there is in the lateral column, if we come in the thoracic region, from thoracic 1 to L2 region, as I said, there is a lateral horn is also present. And this lateral horn consists of the motor neuron again, but this motor neuron, they are not somatic, they are not under your will, and they are the sympathetic neuron, okay? They are classified as preganglionic autonomic neurons or preganglionic sympathetic neurons, okay, in the thoracic region, preganglionic sympathetic. We have already seen the nuclei present in the posterior horn. Let us go to the transverse section of his spinal cord, where the neurons are present in many groups. And these neurons, they will be classified into three groups, a medial group, okay, and then an central or intermediate group, and then here the lateral group. So they are divided into three groups, medial group, central group, and the lateral group. and then they are having subdivisions in medial group, in central group, and in the lateral group. For example, here in medial group, you are seeing the dorsomedial and ventromedial, or enteromedial and postomedial group of the nuclei. In central group, in the cervical region, you will get accessory nucleus, okay, and phrenic nucleus. But if this enlargement is from the lumbosacral region, then you will get only one nuclei, nucleus, and that is called as the lumbosacral nuclei, okay, lumbosacral nuclei. If we see the lateral group, there are many nuclei are seen, ventrolateral, dorsolateral, then retrodorsolateral, okay, and it is called as retrodorsal. And if this is a sacral enlargement where it is passing from S2 to the S4 segment level, then again an autonomic neuron will be seen, and that is called as intermedio lateral group of the nucleus, okay, intermedio lateral group of the nuclei, which in the S2 to S4 region is a group of the nuclei which is parasympathetic group, okay, parasympathetic. There may be many other subdivision, but this is the major subdivision which we used to teach. Otherwise, so many other neurons group are there, okay, in the ventral horn, in the ventral horn. Let us move to the next slide. And here, why the anterior column is arranged in different motor nuclei? So many groups of the neurons which are called as the nuclei, okay? Why it is arranged in so many? It was worked out, okay? Okay, and this was said that this group of nuclei, they send their axon, okay, either as the alpha and the gamma motor neuron, and they supply to the skeletal muscle groups of the skeletal muscle having a similar function. And these were thus arranged into two different groups, that is anterior and posterior, or ventral and dorsal, serving the different function. For example, if we see the group here, the neuron supplying from medial to lateral, the medial most neuron here, 1 and 2 which are shown here, enteromedial and the postromedial group. Here, one is postromedial, two is enteromedial, they will go to the trunk, where they will supply, the number one group will supply to the flexor muscle, number two group will supply to the extensor muscle. Similar is for shoulder, similar is for, then it will go to the arm, and if you see the arm, the ventral group of the neuron will supply the flexor, the dorsal group of neuron will supply to the extensor of arm. That means the ventral group of the neuron here will supply triceps, and dorsal will supply the biceps muscle. I'm making it very easy for you. Okay, then this is the area for neurons of forearm, and most laterally, this is the area for the neurons of the hand. Thus, from mediolateral, okay, arrangement is here, that here is the trunk, then shoulder, then arm, then forearm, and then hand. So you can also visualize this for that of the lower limb watching.